الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي أما بعد يقول المولى جل وعلا ومن أظلم ممن منع مساجد الله أن يذكر فيها اسمه وسعى في خرابها أولئك ما كان لهم أن يدخلوها إلا خائفين لهم في الدنيا خزي ولهم في الآخرة عذاب عظيم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of the masajid. And as we know, the masajid, as he says in many places in the Quran, وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ فَلَا تَدْعُوا مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. That the masajid on the face of the earth are solely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning that they are the only designated places for worship, where ibadah at large in its general definition is acceptable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No other designated place on the face of the earth that people have established to worship or commit shirk, as more appropriately expressed, except that the ibadah is rejected from these places. So the only places that are designated for the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth are the masajid. وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ فَلَا تَدْعُوا مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. Do not call on any other entity whatsoever in the masajid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala along with or aside from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says another ayat, فِي بُيُوتٍ أَذِنَ اللَّهُ أَن يُذْكَرَ فِيهَا اسْمُهُ. In places, buyut is the plural of bayt, meaning that a house. أَذِنَ اللَّهُ. So this is an honor for us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permitted us, gives a permission to mention and remember His name, to supplicate to Him, to recite the Qur'an, to make dua, to make ruku', sujood, so on and so forth. In it, there are men are not being distracted by their commerce, trading, business, employment, whatever the case might be. In other words, they come to these masajid solely for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the status of these masajid first and foremost in the hearts of the believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ. And who is more of an unjust person, a transgressor. And as we read in Surah Luqman, يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. If shirk in itself is a great sin, and in fact it's the greatest sins of all. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is even more unjust for one to prevent the masajid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from acts of worship to be, you know, done in it. And not only that, to go to the extent of ruining these masajid by way of the prevention of the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and by way of the physical destruction of the masajid. And what do we see now? If you go to almost any place in the Muslim world, you will see that the masajid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are being destroyed. People are being prevented from making the adhan, from doing salah, from recitation of the Quran, so on and so forth. More specifically, you'll find in Egypt, you know, at this point, there's a deliberate effort to obliterate anything called Islam in it. They want to turn it from a Muslim country into a secular country. And the way they do this, by systematically targeting the masajid and systematically targeting those who go to the masajid. So one way is to prevent people from going to the masajid. And if you prevent people from going to the masajid, then of course their news channels are going to start saying, nobody's going to these masajid, let's just remove them. And this is the next step, and you will see that if they continue successfully in this path, they're going to be shutting down these masajid one after the other. Look in Syria what they're doing. Look in Iraq. Anywhere you go. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not describe reality in this area. Because he says, أُولَٰئِكَ مَا كَانَ لَهُمْ أَن يَدْخُلُوهَا إِلَّا خَائِفِينَ. For those who engage in such behavior, such mischief, they should not enter it or cannot enter it except in a state of fear. But we see that they're entering it with their shoes on, with their military uniforms, with their police uniforms, with their, you know, vans and trucks, you know, loading the musallin afterwards, killing them, taking their bodies out, so on and so forth. We see them doing this in a state of utmost security. There's no signs of fear on their faces, so on and so forth. So is this ayah inconsistent with the reality? No. This ayah talks about the believers and our level of faith within us. It does not talk about our strength in terms of military power, physical power, or any power whatsoever. It talks about our state of iman. وَلَكَمَا كَانَ لَهُمْ أَن يَدْخُلُوهَا إِلَّا خَائِفِينَ So, it is the musallin, those who come to the masajid, that are in a state of fear. It is not those who destroy the masajid. Why is that? This reflects the shallow and superficial level of iman that the Muslims have in their hearts now. In other words, it's not about military power. I'll give you an example. And this is the only place I know of that the Muslims are so weak and so surrounded, but yet the occupation and the military forces are so afraid of them. Look in Jerusalem, for example, the Masjid al-Aqsa. You will find that whenever there's any danger or declaration of war or invasion of the Masjid, that everybody, man, woman, and child, they let go of everything they're doing and they head for Masjid al-Aqsa. Some of them return, some don't return. Some of them return to their homes, some get martyred. Some get injured, end up in the hospital. Some get arrested, end up in prison. But you will see that the occupation there, Zionism there, when it comes to Masjid al-Aqsa, they know for a fact, this is not a place you can mess with. Even though there's a plot to destroy it from underneath. But I'm talking about here in terms of what people see and what people can do. In spite of the fact they're under occupation, in spite of the fact they are militarily pretty close to nothing, really. We're talking about men, women, and children that have no weapons whatsoever. The only weapon they can use are stones. But yet, they unleash the might that they have. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will only hold you responsible according to your capacity. So they've done everything within their capacity, so therefore they threw the fear in the heart of the occupation. And that's why you see that they still, you know, to one level or another, freely practice their deen, and people who go to visit from all over the world, they enter al-Masjid, and there is hardly any interference according to eyewitnesses who went to visit the Masjid al-Aqsa. So, when our iman recedes in our hearts, you see that the enemies of Islam have the belligerence and have the audacity to commit atrocities in the masajid, including imprisoning those who go to the masajid and including preventing those who go to pray and remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the masajid. So this ayah does not talk about reality. It talks about the ideal of how the masajid should be treated and how the Muslims should defend their masajid, that they should exert their very best in order to defend these masajid. وَلَكَمَا كَانَ لَهُمْ أَن يَدْخُلُوهَا إِلَّا خَائِفِينَ لَهُمْ فِي الدُّنْيَا خِزْي In this dunya they shall be disgraced. And we see that the overwhelming majority of these people are in a state of disgrace at one point or another in this dunya. وَلَهُمْ فِي الْآخِرَةِ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ And indeed they have a severe punishment awaits them in the hereafter. Then in the following ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلِلَّهِ الْمَشْرِقُ وَالْمَغْرِبُ So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belongs the east and the west. How come this ayah does not talk about north and south? Because indeed all directions belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because in the past, people really did not know, but talking about the average person here, the illiterate person, did not know about the east and the west, where the sun rises and where the sun sets. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, even if you are in that state, with a masajid, where the enemies of Islam have put between you and the masjid, and they prevented you from establishing your salah and your dhikr and your recitation of the Quran within inside the masjid, indeed, لِلَّهِ الْمَشْرِقُ وَالْمَغْرِبُ فَأَيْنَمَا تُوَلُّوا فَثَمَّ وَجْهُ اللَّهِ The remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the event you are prevented from coming to the masjid is not solely in the masjid, it's everywhere. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the earth for this ummah a masjid. Has made the earth for this ummah a masjid. I will conclude with just a small word for us to reflect upon. In order to heighten the sanctity and the divinity of the masjid inside our hearts. Because unless we do that, then the masjid to us is just another place to come to and hang out. You know, we can read the Quran, we can play. We can do our business, or we can do recitation of the Quran. And to some, unfortunately, the two seem to be somewhat equal. The masajid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we mentioned, they are the only places that are designated for the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that dhikr and ibadah, collectively, recitation of the Quran, remembrance, istighfar, so on and so forth, is acceptable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we practice certain etiquettes, These etiquettes are more likely to elevate the sanctity of the masjid within our hearts. And if that happens, we'll do our very best to establish these masajid, you know, with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and by way of building and expanding these masajid. First and foremost, when you come to the masjid, perform your wudu at home. Every hadith that I've ever read about, you know, the ajr of coming to the masjid, be it walking or driving or riding any other way of coming to the masjid, it talks about whoever performs the wudu at home. In other words, the masjid is not a place for us to come and make ghusl, or to come and perform your ablution, or so on and so forth, to come and cleanse yourself. No, you come to the masjid clean. And you wear garments that are clean as well, that represents you as a Muslim, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُدَّثِّرْ قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَهِّرْ. So you have to be careful about the garments that you wear to the masjid. They do not reflect any symbols, be it advertisement for those who make garments and make clothing, so on and so forth, or be it any other slogans that you may, you know, find, you know, a shirt or what have you on sale that carries. We don't come to those, you know, we don't wear those to the masjid. So you purify yourself and you purify your clothes and you perform your ablution, and then you come to the masjid. And you come early. Oftentimes, yani the Prophet ﷺ tells us, when you come to the masjid, فَمَا أَدْرَكْتَ فَصَلِّ وَمَا فَاتَكَ فَقْضِي. So we see that people come into the masjid and the imam says Allahu Akbar, or is about to say, you know, to go into ruku', and they come running. How are you going to achieve khushu'? The Prophet ﷺ said, مَا أَدْرَكْتَ فَصَلِّ. Meaning that you need to come in a state of khushu', in a state of tum'anina, meaning that you feel concentrated, the presence of mind is there, and you stand up and say, Allahu Akbar. Realizing that you're going into your salat al-dhuhr or asr or whatever salat that you join in. So you don't have to catch that last rak'ah by running. And then oftentimes when you run, you're not really standing up straight as you ought to begin your salat. You're kind of leaning forward because you're trying to secure your place and make the takbir of ihram at the same time, which is very difficult to do. So you come to the masjid early, you pray tahiyyat al-masjid, two rak'ahs. It's a sunnah. Yes, it's not obligatory, but it's a sunnah, but that's showing that you honor the masjid that you come to. And then you join the salah. And then after the salah, you sit down, you do your tasbih and your dhikr. When you enter the masjid, you say, A'udhu billahi al-azim, wa biwajhi al-kareem, wa bisultanihi al-qadeem, min ash-shaytan al-rajeem, bismillahi ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Allahumma aftah li abwaab rahmatik. Realizing that you're making a dua to enter the house of the all generous, of the one who holds all bounties. So you ask him from his bounties. Allahumma yas'aluka min fadlika al-azim. Oh Allah, I ask you from your great bounties. Then when you exit, of course you sit in the masjid, you know, abstain as much as you can from worldly matters. It's not like it's prohibited, but it's highly undesirable that you engage yourself in worldly matters unless it's necessary. And if you must engage yourself in any worldly matter, you know, observe the rights of others who are trying to concentrate on their ibadah, and just exit the masjid. Go to the lobby, go outside, do whatever you need to do. When you exit the masjid, you also make your dua. You enter with the right, and you make your dua, and you exit with the left foot, and you make your dua. Bismillah, as-salatu was-salamu ala Rasulillah. Allahumma yas'alik min fadlik al-azim. Allahumma asimni min ash-shaytan al-rajim. Oh Allah, I ask you from your greatest bounties, again, as you enter and as you exit. Because he's the one who holds all the bounties. Allahumma asimni min ash-shaytan al-rajim. Oh Allah, protect me from Satan. When we begin the recitation of the Qur'an, or the dua, or any act of ibadah whatsoever, why is it that we say, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan al-rajim? Because if we are left to ourselves, and our efforts, and our knowledge, whatever it is, to deal with Satan, he's going to defeat us. And the only one who's going to help us defeat Satan is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why he commands us, وَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ فَاعْتَصِمْ بِاللَّهِ وَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ فَاسْتَعِدْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. Say, Allah, I seek refuge in you from Satan, because none can defeat him but you. None can defeat Satan but the creator of Satan. So some of these adriyah, some of these etiquettes that we can practice as we enter the masjid, that I'm going to an important place. I purify myself, I purify my garments, I perform my ablution, I come to the masjid in a state ready to render the act of worship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded me to do. هذا والله تعالى أعلى وأعلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون. وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خيرا السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.